Hello, I'm back, and the award season's been going on lately, and I saw the Golden Globes, this big stuff about Oprah running for president, said by many people, like they'd vote for her. And that was kind of a big thing. And there were some people who I wanted to win at the Golden Globes, such as, Gary Oldman, who I've been talking about for The Darkest Hour. He was really good. He's winning. He won the Golden Globe, he won some award that indicates, or that has indicated, said winner, recipient will win the Oscar. James Franco won for The Disaster Artist, brought Tommy Wiseau up and his brother. Pretty cool. Though we didn't think Greg Sestero was kind of a bummer, but they did show him at the table, so there's something. They also Ewan McGregor won, which was for Fargo. I was happy he won. He didn't win the Emmy, which I was a bit disappointed with. I forget who won the Emmy. Emmy, but he won a Golden Globe and now the Critics' Choice Awards. They just happened. As well as, James Franco won an actor in a comedy for The Disaster Artist, but Gary Oldman won Best Actor overall. So I was happy about that. Though Dunkirk did not win a single Golden Globe. I've talked about how I enjoyed Dunkirk recently, or actually over the course of the last year since it came out. I still maintain it's the best film of last year. I know some people will say otherwise, but for me, I'm just like, when I heard some of the complaints, like the big one was that, a little character development. You don't really know the characters, and I believe I've said how that's fine. I'm happy with that because, quite honestly, their actions in the film, the characters' actions, actually tell us all we need to know about them. Them, for a moment, like for 5 minutes or so, like the lead character, Finn Whitehead. He's talking to Harry Styles and his friend, the French friend, who doesn't talk really till the end. Spoiler alert, he's French, but then again, throughout the film, it becomes pretty interesting that he doesn't say anything. So in a way, I guess that is a spoiler, but perhaps not to some, maybe. But like when watching, it's like that's not hard to. That he's not exactly, the same, though. Then again, from the right in the opening, it's kind of obvious. I mean, he's burying a soldier who's died, took his clothes to blend in. So, there's first thing, a big tip off. If you didn't really pay attention to that, maybe some didn't. But their actions really tell you all you need to know about them. One thing with Christopher Nolan is people are like, well, he has some good character development, like such as like the Batman films, Bruce Wayne stories, good character development with his character and relationship with Gordon and all those guys. People think Nolan has the characters say, like he writes dialogue that over explains everything, like we can tell what's going on. You don't need certain things explained. You know, you can see it. I never thought that was a real problem, but that's just me. But people seem to complain about that. I don't know whether he listens to people or is really in the know. He doesn't really ever use... Yeah, he doesn't use cell phones. He doesn't have an email. He doesn't do that stuff like you or I would do. I have email. You probably have email. But yeah, whether he's heard these complaints or not, I either way, you know, this is a film where you know as much information as all the soldiers know. If you hear from, like, say, Kenneth Brenna's character, because he's a commander, he hears this. As the time he hears it, you hear it. Because it's exactly like how the situation would have been in Dunkirk. The fastest you could hear of something is if it came from a higher up and telling all the soldiers this or that. And, yeah, so there's that complaint. Some people think Dunkirk's boring. Like, there's no enough action or this or that. Like, and I think people kind of wanted it to be a rated R film and have blood and gore, but that wasn't the point. The whole point of Dunkirk and the way it was told was because it's a survival story, and it is because everyone there on the beach is trying to survive. They're there for like a week. They want to get off, and they can't. Homes. Right there, they can see it across the channel, but they can't get there. You got ships, boats. They get bombed from the air, shot at. People are shot at on the land, and even in the sea. There's also U-boats that sink ships. So even if it seems all fine and dandy, they're U-boats and they sink ships. A lot of ships and stuff sank during the evacuation of Dunkirk, and it's quite a lot when you really think about it, considering how many days the whole thing took place. Which was 10 days, and, development and not enough action or whatever. It's not really, I thought it had a good pace. I enjoyed it, the film. You know, it's basically, it's as definitive of a story about the evacuation of Dunkirk as you could ever have. Have enough time in the air, have enough time on the sea with the boats, and have enough time on the land to get to know main character through the actions and everybody. That's the thing, their actions tell us all who they are, and we care about them because they're people. This event happened to people, and there were some soldiers who were alive during Dunkirk and are still alive today, and they said they saw it, and they were like, it was like, I went back there to 1940 and I could see my friends when I was watching the movie. Like, maybe not every single thing that happened in the film happened to them, but many of the situations and things that happened, a good number of people did experience some of that stuff. And Nolan himself talked to people who were survivors that were still around and talked to them and interviewed. The special features if you have a Blu-ray. I think if you have, there's like a 2-disc DVD that you can get. But if you get that, you can watch the special features and they have the making of the film. And they even have some of the people, like some of the soldiers, where they're interviewed. And it's really quite amazing. Their stories. And there's stuff that Nolan was told from talking to them. Some stuff was put in the movie as a result of that, like put in the script and reenacted on screen. Like, for instance, like there's a hole mole, and they're going on to the mole, and they're everyone's crowded, they can't go anywhere. There's like this, there's like a, kind of like a dock, that bridge, like I think like a dock, and walking, and there's like this hole from like a bombing, like as the plane went by, like a bomb went through, and there's this big hole, and there's a plank there that you had to go, you had to walk across it, and that's in the movie. You know, there's a lot of real life stuff that happened, and basically, I could go on about Dunkirk, but basically, it's about wars, and just my enjoyment and my love for that film. I was disappointed Dunkirk did not win a single Golden Globe. It was nominated for 3. I think it should have been nominated for more, like for like something for acting. I think like say Kenneth Branagh or Mark Rylance for supporting actor. Finn Whitehead is very good, though whether he would have gotten in for best actor is, I don't know, and especially up against someone like Gary Oldman as Winston Churchill, the chances of him winning were very low if he was nominated, but he gave a good, an amazing performance for like his first film. I believe that's his first film. That was a very good performance. I care about him. I care about basically, you know, everybody really in that film. And it was just upset or disappointed, not upset. I was really riding on it, winning, but you know, I was just disappointed that I'm like, you know, it was nominated for Best Picture and Director. And also original score. And score and directing went to The Shape of Water. The Shape of Water. I don't know why I basically said Wario. But I haven't seen that movie. I've seen the trailer, and I've heard some stuff. I even watched like a review that was a non-spoiler review, so if I do see it, nothing's spoiled for me. But, you know, I think it's a movie I'll wait to come to see when it comes out. Not one I'm going to run out to the theater to see. It's just, I don't know, it just doesn't, I don't know, it's just, it's interesting. Like, that doesn't seem like the kind of film that would win, like, Best Picture at one of those things. And then won Best Picture at the Critics' Choice Awards also, which happened. And Director as well. 3 billboards outside of Ebbing, Missouri. Won Best Picture at the Golden Globes. Haven't seen that either. Sam Rockwell and one supporting actor at the Golden Globes and Critics' Choice Awards as well. And Frances McDormand won Best Actress at both awards shows. And, yeah, it's just interesting to see how Dunkirk really doesn't get anything. Though at the Critics' Choice Awards, it didn't win Best Editing. And I didn't watch, unlike the Golden Globes, I watched that. I didn't watch the Critics' Choice Awards, but I saw at the end, like, the results, and I was like, this is interesting. And, but yeah, my best editing is it. I mean, nothing more. I thought Dunkirk was fantastic. I wish, you know, Darkest Hour, you know, it won Best Actor in Makeup, rightfully deserved. So it could have gotten something else. I think, Kristen Scott Thomas, she should have won something at either of those awards, like supporting actress. Yeah, here. Just not the list. Not all these. dumb whatever news articles that are just going to talk about not show the winners. Allison Jenny won for Itania. I could go on with the listing, but yeah. It's interesting that a film like Dunkirk, which, you know, audiences enjoyed it, they kept going back. Critics enjoyed it, but I don't know, it's like, I didn't really hear a whole lot of stuff about the Shape of Water at all. Like, there's some trailers and stuff, no real hype or anything. I mean, it's Guillermo del Toro, so you know, there is an audience there. And he has some good stuff. I'm not an Uber fan, but, you know, I've seen Pan's Labyrinth. That was pretty cool, I thought. What else did he do? Did Hellboy. That was fine. Hellboy 2. But yeah, he, you know, he's made some good stuff, some interesting stuff, but I don't know, I mean, I don't know, then again, maybe I have to watch it to understand, but I don't know. It looks like it could be like a Birdman situation for me, where I saw Birdman and I wasn't really impressed. To me, Zach Galifianakis and Emma Stone were the best parts of that film. I know many will disagree, but I don't know. It was hyped so much, and nobody really told me any actual plot points, so there's no real spoilers for me, but it was one of those films where it was so hyped up that I was disappointed. And some could be like that with Dunkirk. It was hyped up, and then I was disappointed or whatever. With Christopher Nolan, it seems like any film since The Dark Knight Inception has to be absolute perfection in exactly how you think it will turn out or something along those lines where it's got to be perfect. And honestly, there's no perfect movies. I mean, Dunkirk, you know, it's inspired by true events. And there were some liberties taken, but those were taken just so, you know, the film's a bit more interesting, or to mainstream people, at least, because unless you're like interested in history or you're British, you may not really be all that fond, because it's very important to German history, I guess, too, but British history, because there's this Dunkirk spirit in Britain. You could kind of compare that sort of, since, you know, I'm American, around that time with Pearl Harbor and how people responded and banded together during those days. You could also say how it's also important for French history, obviously, because Dunkirk's in France. So, and then that area, like in Europe, particularly around that area of Europe, it's probably very important there. We're here in America because we weren't in the war yet. It's not that we don't care, but it's, I guess, not as interesting as, per se, like Pearl Harbor or something like that. Though the film about Pearl Harbor we've got now is just, bleh. I mean, it's like, you could make a 2-hour film or so about the event of Pearl Harbor, like have a few minutes of stuff going on, and then, you know, different perspectives of people. I mean, you could make a 2-hour movie about that very easily. But no, get Michael Bay and have a love story that's completely pointless, and there's like a 15-minute section at the end, which is the Pearl Harbor thing. I understand, like, oh, we want you to care about these characters, like, it's happened, whatever. whether they're based on real people or not. There's a good chance I'm going to care about them because of I know what happens, and it's just going to be very unfortunate. Like, you see, you can just have like 5-10 minutes or so of you seeing some of the main characters, and you like them, you get to know them, and then all of a sudden, you know, here comes, you know, the Japanese to come and bomb it. And I'm not trying to be sound like I am up against Japanese, but that's what happened. You know, the Japanese came and bombed Pearl Harbor, and we responded to that, and what happened. And I know that sounds stupid, but there's always going to be that one person like, Japanese, and that's rude. It's like, and everyone gets offended and upset over everything. It's like, if you don't clarify just a little bit, you're... But, you know, that's like what happened, similar of a spirit of what happened over for England to America. Like, it's kind of like a... It's not the same, obviously, but like the sort of spirit of banding together kind of thing is what I could connect, at least with American audiences. And I cared about the people there watching the film, and it was really, sorry, my leg itches. But it's really a good, it's a good film. Darkest Hour is a great film as well. It's my top two films of the year. Dunkirk's first, and then close second, it's Darkest Hour, and I don't know. Yeah, Birdman, I saw a trailer that looked odd and interesting, but, and while it's Guillermo del Toro, so he makes some interesting and odd stuff, and not in a good way, you know, with creatures and monsters. But, you know, with this, I don't know, it's like, oh no. These wars was like, it was very, like, sort of political driven, and maybe some of these wins had something to do with it for, like, the person who's receiving it, or I don't know. I mean, it's just, and I'm saying that because of that kind of environment that's happening, you know, but Me Too after, and now it's Time's Up now. That was a new thing. I didn't know that until I saw the Golden Globes. And I saw the Golden Globes because it was like this, at a theater where every year they come, they people come to watch the Golden Globes at this theater. It's free. And, yeah, you can win prizes if you guess correctly on most of the stuff. Most of the categories. I won something. I won like a $20 gift thing to go to that theater again. It's a pretty good theater. So they have a film that they're going to play. I'll probably use that. I don't know if I'll watch The Shape of Water there. Because that theater, it's local. And also, they kind of... You know, they show more independent films. I mean, they did show Dunkirk, so they will show big, kind of like Hollywood films. But they kind of like to try and show more indie films, or art house films, foreign films. But you know, just interesting with all the hype and praise and all of this and that. Like, all of a sudden, like Shape of Water comes. And when did that come out? December. Okay. Yeah, December 1st. So, yeah, it's around that time where it's like at the end of the year. I heard some stuff about it and then kind of went away from me. And then it came back around the award time. And now, like, Shape of Water is like winning stuff. Three billboards, one stuff. But yeah, I don't know. Some of those movies look interesting. I'll probably see them when they come out. But, you know, the fact that Dunkirk doesn't have didn't win anything at the Golden Globes. The fact that Darkest Hour wasn't nominated for more than just, you know, than Best Actor. That was all it was nominated for and won. And I feel also like Dunkirk and Darkest Hour should have won more. I mean, you obviously know where I feel with Dunkirk with Best Picture and Director. I also think it should have won Music and some sort of acting award, but, you know, Chris Scott Thomas also should have won Supporting Actress. They are nominated for the BAFTAs, though it was like nominated for like 12 BAFTAs is The Shape of Water or something, 12 or 14. Somewhere it was 12. Okay, no, 14 for The Shape of Water at the Critics' Choice. So it was BAFTAs that was it won. Yeah. 9 nominations at the BAFTAs is how much Darkest Hour got. Dunkirk got 8, both nominated for Best Film, Best Actor for Gary Oldman in Darkest Hour, Best Director for Christopher Nolan, Dunkirk, and other awards. Though it's just interesting that Dunkirk has no acting awards because people I've seen like praised Mark Rylance, praised Kenneth Branagh, and Tom Hardy did get praise, as did Cillian Murphy, but Brenna and Rylance really, they were excellent. Tom Hardy was also, he still has a mask on, which is interesting. Even in Inception, he had a burlap sack over his head for a bit. So in a way, he was, his face was hidden there too, but not like Bane or Mad Max or Dunkirk. But yeah, maybe at the BAFTAs, Dunkirk will get more love. It's nominated for a PGA, for the Producers Guild Award. It's nominated for the Directors Guild Award of America. America, but yeah, they're not. It's not Dunkirk's nominated for those. Not sure about Darkest Hour. Perhaps that is. Yeah, it doesn't look like Darkest Hour is nominated for Best Picture, the Producers Guild, but, you know, that's just my thoughts on the award shows, particularly revolving Dunkirk and Darkest Hour. There's like a lot of, I think they're trying to rectify a lot of this women stuff. Like, that's been happening. So perhaps some things won because of that. They're trying to kind of make up for that. You know, that's just, that's all up in the air, you know. Don't want to say that's what they're doing, but it kind of looks that way. I wish, if it's true, that is true, I wish it wasn't, because it's like then the real best film, or the real best actor or actress in these categories didn't win. And perhaps they should have, but, or this person won because they're more outspoken on stuff like this. Not just after all this stuff has come about, but before, perhaps even. But it's just like, if that's true and that's what's happening, it's a real shame. Though that this kind of thing has, that kind of thing has happened before, so be really as big surprise if it happened again. But that's all I've got to say on the matter. See you next time. Okay.